Hi everybody, welcome on board. This is Archana Malhotra. We welcome you to this new online session, World Spa Ki Baatcheet. Thanks to the bomb, they have not only been working relentlessly for our safety and sustenance, but they've also planned for online activities and educative sessions with leaders. For everyone, all lines will be on listen-only mode. We'll throw open the discussion for questions once the session is over. Do type your questions and send us on the chat. And now for the introduction, I introduce Mr. R.S. Sharma, former chairman and managing director of ONGC. Mr. Sharma, still very active in the industry, is on the board of many companies. He's often seen on business channels as the industry expert, and in his personal capacity has been advising Mr. Amitabh Kant of Niti Aayog on policy-related matters. Welcome, Mr. Sharma, and thank you for being here with us.
Thank you, Mr. Sharma.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you very much, Ashna. And to begin with, I would like to compliment BOMB, the kind of efforts they have been doing to give comfort to the residents here, never before kind of challenge to the mankind. And this unique initiative, I would put it off on informal sharing. Information sharing is indeed great. I must say that's a good comfort. And these days, aajkal kya hai? Kuch karne ko hota nahi hai. So what I do these days, so I occupy one of the rooms, I start my old song. So yesterday I got a call from Tarun Arora, Mr. Sharma, what are you doing? Maine kaha is waqt 40s ke gaane chal rahe hain. He asked me whether I am available for anything to do for the community. I said, anything you say, I'll say yes before listening. So that's it, how it started. And again, Rakesh, which has done a tremendous job to making us have this connect. I was not sure how this will happen. And Arshna, I got your mail at 1:23 last night when you put down that this is the way we'll be structuring. So that's a huge comfort for me, that at least puts me a lot of comfort. Anyway, I'm available. Where do I start?
Thank you very much. It's great to have you here. And let's start with the first question, should we?
Yeah, sure.
So, Mr. Sharma, what's your view on the current oil and gas scenario in the Indian economy and internationally?
Yeah. So before I speaking, let me put a caveat. I don't claim to be an expert. So I used to be, chased by the channel so long. I was chairman of FICCI Hydrocarbon Committee and mentor until December last year. So I have slowed down quite a bit. So I give a lot of my time to the personal affairs, family affairs. But still, whatever I can share, surely I would like to, but whatever I know, I would like to share with the community here. Well, this global oil industry is in absolute shambles. Basically, US shale industry, which indeed revived, if we remember the 2008, July 2008, crude prices had gone up to $140 plus a barrel. And that was the time the breakthrough shale, the production technology had been done, but the production had not started. But that is a stage when it dwelt on that, yes, this industry is a reality, it's not a just a story. And that's a unique technology. I don't think I'll need to go into that. But thereafter, the industry has a lot of stability has come. So prices thereafter have not gone to three-digit level. Last they were seen perhaps until 11, 12, and thereafter they have been all cool. But this situation has put all the producers, Russia, Saudi, their economies are dependent on oil revenue, shale industries in the virtual coma state, and everybody connected with this. You have seen that crude oil prices, the way the crash happened, 5th of March was the OPEC Plus meeting. OPEC Plus is OPEC countries plus Russia. And that the talks fell through. Russia said he is not willing to cut down on the production. Then Saudi said, if you are not willing to cut, we can manage it $1 a barrel also. And that's how it happened. Next day, prices 6th of March were $45. And Monday, they opened at $32. So that is the way it has happened. And then this COVID-19 has only acted as a multiplier effect. And right now, we see that Brent today is less than 26 or around 26. And WTI is less than 24. So actually the cargoes, physical cargoes on the high seas, they are getting traded today. I was reading yesterday only. They are getting traded at $15 to $18 a barrel also.
Wow. When we talk here, when we that's hear a huge drop.
Yeah. When we hear spot prices, these prices are relevant for deliveries next month. And when I say physical trade is that is actual that happening. That's a situation, global situation. In India also, in my active 2 decades in the industry, I have not seen a situation like this. In fact, first time ever ONGC forced to reduce gas production, refineries forced to reduce their refinery processing. So, and the whole industry is in deep shock. And tomorrow seems to be more uncertain.
Gloomy and uncertain. That's true. Yeah. That's actually what my next question was, that the prices of oil for India in early March were about $55 per barrel. And now they have dropped in the recent weeks to $25 per barrel. And that's almost a 50% drop, or maybe a little more than 50% drop. And why hasn't the benefit of this 50% decrease come to the common man?
Arshna, the same question was asked to me by Z Business on a Monday 9th. And they said, will this, all the benefit will get passed on to the consumer? I said, no. My experience last 20 years said it will not come to the consumer. Government will increase the excise duty to pad up their fiscal deficit situation. And that precisely happened on 14th of March. And so that the, whatever the benefit that should have come to the consumer, that has been taken away by the government. That's what happened. And there's something more shocking information for the consumer. When the finance bill has been passed, I think 2-3 days back, whenever it has been passed, the government has introduced an amendment there to have taken permission of the parliament to raise excise duty by another 8 rupees per liter on petrol as well as diesel, saying that they would need more than 100,000 crore to deal with this COVID-19 situation. So that is a cushion they have kept. So the one thing is there, consumer should know for sure that they are not getting any reduction in the prices. On the contrary, increases might happen, because with this India virtually in the lockdown situation, consumption as it is not happening. So that is everybody is uncertain what is there tomorrow, going to happen tomorrow. So that's why the benefit did not get passed on. And yesterday Rakesh was asking that dollar has rupee has depreciated so much against dollar, so that would have cushioned some of the benefit. Well, that from 72, today it is was trading when I last saw it 75 rupees 30 paisa. So that is just about 5-6% depreciation, as against that 55-60%.
I would have thought
in the prices. So true. That's the situation.
I would have thought that the consumer will at least get a 40% decrease, somewhere a drop in the prices as a breather. against all the price increases and everything that's happening?
On the contrary, be ready for special COVID-19 levy. Because today FM has announced 1,70,000 crore fiscal package. They are already stressed. But one thing is there in the interaction with the PM head with the industry leaders, and which I have been saying very often, which Fiki, the president, Sangeeta Reddy, she said, Mr. Prime Minister, don't care for the fiscal deficit now. Let it be off by another 2%. Right now, the need is to sustain the economy. I think that is a correct, should happen the same way. That's all.
So, partially we've already heard, but what is the other impact of the COVID-19 going to be for the oil industry internationally and on India, apart from the petroleum crisis?
Well, as I mentioned, this COVID-19 has only accentuated the crisis in the global industry. US, until a week back, the impact of COVID-19 was not felt to be so severe, but we have seen each day. Now the daily new infections and the daily the deaths happening there, they are perhaps going to overtake China. So that is the global impact. Already industry, in fact, everybody is just keeping fingers crossed what is going to happen. And so is applicable here also for the, I feel, consumer also. They should be ready to tighten the belt, those who can afford. And it is felt that those who consume petrol and diesel, they can still tighten their belt to give relief to the people who are hungry today. We have so much of, exchanges that casual labor and all, they need to be fed. Basically, that is government's responsibility. We need to support the government for this decision. At our own, we keep, supporting the NGOs. So that it does not get, the benefit does not get equitably shared once government takes that responsibility, and rightly so. So that is a way we should support that government decision in the process. Whatever hardship comes to us, we should happily accept.
Thank you. And 85% of our oil consumption is imported from Iraq, Saudi Arabia and other countries. Can we stock up now that the oil prices are low?
I answered this very question Hindu is carrying a story on this newspaper on Sunday. That is a wishful thinking, and that is to tell you intent of the government also, that we need to have at least 1 month the crude inventory for any crisis, and ideally it should be 90 days. China is already having this 1 month inventory with them, and they are moving towards 90 days. India today has the storage capacity of only 9 days. There's a special purpose vehicle, ISPRL, Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserves Limited, subsidiary of this OIDB. So about 4,500 crores has been spent for three underground storage caverns have been built at Mangalore, Puddur, both in Karnataka, and one in Vizag. Total aggregate, the capacity of storage is 5.33 million tons. And I know some part of the storage at Mangalore, which I have personally seen when it was under construction, has been leased out to ADNOC, the National Oil Company of Abu Dhabi. Of course, that will, with the assurance that whenever it gets released from there, it will be given for the Indian refineries only. Each of the refineries, they keep an inventory in their tankages for 10 to 15 days. So that's the situation. We can't stock up. Not possible. And second, there are even talks, research analysts say it will go less than $20. So who takes the call to the risk to buy today at 25, 26, the prices are going to crash more. But the fact is, I know, I read in the media, Indian Oil Corporation, the decision has already been taken there to fill up all that capacity which is available in this Indian this underground caverns. So that is what that is all I know as of now. And government has in fact also taken a decision. Three more projects are under implementation for building extra capacity of 6.5 million tons additional inventory at three other locations. I'm not precisely remembering the location. One is in Orissa, and I think one in Karnataka somewhere. I'm not too sure.
So you had earlier stated that renewable energy production in India is only 8%. I remember having a discussion with you, and you said that it's only 8% of its primary energy requirement, and 55% is coal, 30% oil.
Yeah, I missed out. I'm sorry, you know, in my initial address.
Yeah, we had
if a conversation. If we look at the India's you know, energy scenario, so 55% of that primary energy basket is met by coal, 55 to 56%. 30% is contributed by oil. Gas today is just slightly more than 6%. Remaining 6 to 7% is all about 1% is your
renewable
nuclear. Nuclear.
Hydro.
About 4% is hydro, and remaining this solar wind put together is just 3%. That's it. So there's so much that capacity has been growing up exponentially, but the base itself is so low, it will take quite some time for it to catch up and for us to wish away coal and hydrocarbons, fossil fuels for more energy basket.
So how much time should it take for India to move to more renewable resources to decrease the carbon footprint and to decrease the imports?
Ashna, the most credible document in the world, I'm talking of in the world, is the research document, annual research report released by BP, British Petroleum. Every year, their chief economist comes to India also, and I have been regularly attending his sessions. Usually that happens in February, March. This year it has not yet happened. So I know up to year 18, their report I have seen. And they give analysis, global analysis, country-wise analysis. For India, the analysis is, unfortunately, India is going to remain dependent. There they had given scenario up to 2040. 2040. At 2040, predominantly again, our main energy source will be coal. Gas, which is 6%, and that needs to, that has the best potential in fiscal benefit and through the carbon footprint also. They say in the blue sky scenario, that is most optimistic scenario, it may go up to 12%. Oil may remain wherever it is. Coal may come down, but still it will be the dominant. And this renewables, hydro, with best possible efforts, whatever we are doing, because let us see that, please realize, the total energy demand has also been going up. So when we talk in percentage terms, so renewables are going to remain same, around 10% only, even this 2040 scenario max. Most optimist, it may go 15%, not beyond. Today, even on the global scale, renewables contribute just less than 15%, even on a global scale. Fossil fuels contribute remaining 85%. So these are the harsh realities we should know.
So when the world runs out of oil, that's the most important thing we'll all turn to. And when is the world going to run out of oil?
No, that's let me give you comfort over there. In fact, in the late 90s and early part of this century, there was a peak oil theory was going on. all the Goldman Sachs and the best of the research analysts were saying world will run out of oil, the maximum production can go up to 100 million barrels a day. Beyond that, it will not go, and that's how the crude prices had started rising very steeply around that time. But that theory has been negated with this shale oil discovery in US. And with that, other comfort came that the tar sands in Canada, you know, there the oil is to be mined. It is not drilled. It is there in hard rock form. It is mined along with the sand, and that is heated, and that is where the oil flows. From their tar sands, about 3 million barrels a day, oil is flowing into US. And the largest heavy oil reserves are with Venezuela. If you look at hydrocarbon reserves, maximum is in Venezuela, but that is a very heavy oil, difficult to produce. So comfort for the mankind and for everybody, all participants and you and me, is that world is not going to run out of oil, at least in the foreseeable future. Till we have more, before we can envisage, some more technical breakthroughs will happen, and perhaps the world may reduce its dependence on oil in times to come.
We are all looking forward to that. So according to you, what's the future of electronic vehicles in India?
Well, that's a very good the question. And I tell you, this is the pet project of Amitabh Kant. At any forum he goes, he talks of this. And to share with you, I have a personal connect. Both of us were together on a board for 3 years. And when he came to Niti Aayog, he wanted my help to about the reforms, what reforms should be done in the oil sector. And I actually used to go regularly to Niti Aayog, sit with their teams and giving the recommendations. And he was always saying that we are looking towards the EVs, electrical vehicles. That's a very good thing. Again, I would say that that's an optimistic scenario. Harsh reality is something that again, in fact, Nitin Gadkari, in one of the Siam session where he was invited chief guest, he told all these automakers, by 2030, all your ICE not needed, internal combustion engine not needed, we'll have all electrical vehicles in the country. So when the questions came, the secretary had to negate that statement. And based on my knowledge, again I say that EVs will still continue to play a secondary supportive role to ICE for at least one decade, at least I can say for sure, because there are challenges in EVs. One is that cobalt, lithium, we have to import. And these batteries, China, again, the China is the perhaps, to my knowledge, the biggest supplier. I'm not an expert, perhaps some of the more people in the audience, those who are participating, they may be knowing more. So that's, I don't claim that. But I know that we are dependent on imports. And disposal of these batteries, again, a big issue. And look at the charging, how the charging will happen. That extra power is required. Extra power is required. So that means more coal-based power projects will come. So that is the kind of situation the steel industry is struggling with. In fact, I went to last, I can give you some more this thing. Last, I went to Niti Aayog, and my meeting with Kant was on 2nd of March this month. There, I was sharing with him the one report has been released under task force under my chairmanship, roadmap for a gas-based economy, because PM has given a call to industry that current share of gas should go to 15% by the year 2030. Whereas BP Energy Review says by 2040 also, most optimistic scenario, it is going to be only 12%. But this task force, and anyway, again, I had two very experienced economists in my team. They worked a lot on that. And we have developed a roadmap that 15% is achievable, provided certain questions are answered. So that is where I had a meeting with Amitabh Kant, and then he called his All Energy team. They said, go through their presentation and I want to know to what extent that can be implemented. So there's one national energy policy document with NITI Aayog and earlier Planning Commission they had been working on. So that day I came to know that with all consultation approach from with all ministries, that document has been finalized. It has been submitted to the minister for approval. When that document is released, we'll know that how the government policies are actually moving. But let's wait and watch. Personally, I feel EVs should come in a big way, but let's hope.
We're all waiting for that, I'm sure. So on a lighter note, Mr. Sharma, you've been married for several years, and like most of us actually. So how are you spending your time at home nowadays? And any suggestions to the married couple for survival in these lockdown times?
हाँ वो लास्ट सजेशन मैं जरूर दूंगा बहुत अच्छा है मेरा अपना एक्सपीरियंस हो आई हैव कंप्लीटेड 39 इयर्स लास्ट अक्टूबर सो वेटिंग फॉर इफ वी सर्वाइव टिल द अक्टूबर दिस ईयर टू सेलिब्रेट अवर 40 इयर्स वी डोंट नो व्हाट दिस कोविड-19 हैज इन स्टोर वेल As I said, I have slowed down, deliberately slowed down. I have to request the presidium of FICCI to release me. I can't continue to give my time pro bono, which has been all pro bono. I have my other commitments still. I have 5 boards and none of them is related to oil and gas. So I have been acting advisor, mentoring, though I'm an independent director, but with all the boards, I have been engaged actively. Plus, I am on some NGOs, energy think tank. And now, a lot of my time I try to give to my household. Abhi mujhe ek bahut acha kaam lagta hai har mahine, Spencer's to go with Rashmi. So I hold the cart and she goes on putting the things. So that is one of the duties I have, which I am enjoying.
So good, you're making up for the time lost at home. You're contributing to home as well. That's great. That's a good lesson for everybody.
I have ignored my household all these years.
Great. I'm happy for Rashmi. So, what's your mantra for happiness, Mr. Sharma?
Happiness mantra main aapko nahi bataunga. All that male participants, I will tell them. They'll coolly submit to your wishes to of your better half. And if you see smiles on their faces, you are the happiest person on this earth.
Awesome. I think that's fantastic. So let's have the floor open for questions. And I'm seeing the chat window. Arvind Mathur is asking you, the government is bailing out banks and passing on various benefits to lower income people. The benefit should not be passed on to general consumers like us. What do you say about that?
Yes, precisely. And Anupam Mathur is my immediate neighbor. So we had a good chat on phone also. Perhaps he will recall. And I agree. In fact, in my talk, I have covered. Be ready for this increase in extra excise duty on petrol and diesel up to 8 rupees a liter. That is approval taken by the government from the parliament. So we may have to tighten our belt more to give relief to the hungry, to casual workers, who are in dire need. Perhaps nobody would agree more than this thinking that we can sacrifice to at least let that poor strata of the society, let them get 2 courses of meal.
Thank you, Arvindji. Mr. S.V. Goyal asks you, what will be the future of Shell oil at these prices?
Goyalji, I have also already covered in my talk today. The shale industry in US is in virtual coma. the rigs have been stacked up. Production, whatever, wherever it is happening at a loss. Though that shale industry, they have done marvelous achievement in technology. 10 years back, it was thought shale industry will not survive at a price of less than $70-$80. And they have been operating very much at $40-$50 also. But less than $40 is difficult for them to continue operations. And with these prices, and as I said, crude oils getting sold physical inventories at $15 a barrel. So that industry, they have to close shop with no other option.
So Mr. S.V. Goyal is also asking, how long will this price scenario be? I mean, for how long is it here to stay?
Can Mr. Goyal address the question, how long this COVID-19 is going to trouble the mankind? So today, everything rests on that. I'm sure OPEC Plus, they will come back on the discussion table. The industry can survive, but this crisis, I think, very difficult to say where we are going to.
So Anurag asks, what is the actual production cost per barrel?
I told you that during when their talks crashed, Saudi said we can even survive at $1 a barrel. Thing is, to tell you, for the actually lifting, we call it production cost, operating cost in the oil industry is called lifting cost. That is, once you drill a well, all infrastructure is put in place, then it is a self flow. Nothing gets added except for some chemicals. And then depends that what is the that volume of production from each well. In India, as I was heading ONGC, I can say that ONGC can still survive at $40 a barrel. Beyond that, ONGC is incurring losses. Shale industry, I have told you already. So this scenario, if it continues, so that's a very bad scenario for the oil industry itself.
So Sameer is asking you, my question is that the demand scenario is in a limbo, twin order issue, people can't step out to increase demand. And secondly, when the recession increased NPA happens, then the demand will suffer in the second order. When might this stabilize given limited storage capacity and increased supply?
Well, Sameer, I'm sure you would be in a better position to answer this question, because this more related to economy. But today, whatever I read about economy also, and I do contribute in my interaction on the media also about the economy. Today, everybody is keeping fingers crossed. Nobody knows, even on day-to-day basis, what is going to happen tomorrow. Because yesterday, that WHO ICMRA report says, next 48 hours, extremely crucial for India. So, I don't know what is the casualty list today and where we are heading tomorrow. So, that is the uncertainty, and when we would come out of it, at least I'm not able to say anything.
So, anybody has any more questions or we come to a conclusion? Anybody? I think we've had a good informative discussion, Mr. Sharma.
Before I end the session, and before I say, Arshna, I have been interacting with lot of these TV anchors. All these TV anchors, student business channels, all of them know me. But you have done a fantastic job. Time management, we thought we'll go up to the 5:45. You did right interventions. You kept the interest alive, asked all relevant questions. I'm personally also very happy that all relevant questions were posed.
Thank you very much. And thank you everyone for taking out the time to attend this session. For those from the industry or wanting to know more, and we're all now moving for that cup of tea in the balcony where the music will start. Thanks to Atul and Ranjit.
Yeah, and Devang. Devang as well.
And Devang. Okay, great. Fantastic.
Thank you, everybody.
So, thank you very much. This is your neighbor and thank host, you. Archana Malhotra. Be kind, be patient, be in gratitude. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Take care. Bye-bye.